The sitting is resumed.
It is time for questions to the Minister for Employment and Learning, and we will start with listed questions, and I have to tell you question 5 and 13 have been withdrawn. And I call Mr. Robin Newton. Mr. Newton.
Question number 1, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. As the new Northern Ireland Apprenticeship Strategy, Securing Our Success, was published in June 2014, and Generating Our Success, the new Youth Training Strategy, in June 2015. Together, these strategies set out an ambitious programme of reform that has the potential to radically transform how professional and technical training is delivered. My aim is to establish a world-class skills system which supports and meets the ambitions of our young people and provides Northern Ireland with a skills base capable of driving economic growth. Consistent with the best systems internationally, employers will be firmly in the lead of the reformed system. Through sector partnerships, they will work with curriculum experts to develop and agree the curriculum and content that will form the core of an apprenticeship in each occupational area. These new strategies are focused on raising quality, supporting a breadth of training, underpinning progression and ensuring portability to deliver skills that will be recognised both nationally and internationally as an exemplar. My department is currently progressing with a number of projects which will allow the new system to be fully operational from September 2017. Programme-led apprenticeships were introduced in 2009, were originally intended as a short-term contingency arrangement for apprentices made unemployed as a result of the developing economic downturn. The aim was to provide participants with the knowledge, understanding and competence to work at a high level in their chosen occupation. Unfortunately, the downturn lasted much longer than was originally thought. The programme-led apprenticeship programme was successful in ensuring that young people continued to train at a time when there were no job opportunities. Fortunately, we are now in a different place economically, and the new programme has been developed to support our economy and employers.
Mr. Newton, for supplement.
Can I thank the Minister for that very detailed answer, and I acknowledge that the Minister has recognised the potential of the employer-led scheme, which, as I understand it, results in about 80% plus of the apprentices actually ending up in employment with their host company. Can I ask the Minister why we are not seeking to further expand the employer-led scheme, where it is they recognise that they are meeting the needs of the industry and that where they have an input into and where the jobs are being offered to those who take part in the employer-led scheme?
Well, I thank the member for his comments, and can I assure him that our ambitions in this respect have no limits whatsoever. We want to see as much training happening through the apprenticeship system as we possibly can. In essence, any professional or technical area is something that can be addressed through the apprenticeship approach. As the member will appreciate, an apprenticeship is a job. Someone will be in employment as part of and will be trained both on the job and off the job. Employers are in the driving seat, and they're the ones who are determining where apprentice opportunities will be created, because they're in essence creating jobs. In the past, we've had a situation where apprenticeships have been awarded as part of contracts to suppliers who will then try to create jobs in particular areas. That's not the most efficient way of engaging with the market, particularly in those areas that are evolving as high growth areas. So I fully would suggest to the member that we have in place the precise mechanisms. Our challenge now is to make sure that we implement the strategy and we get as much buy-in from employers as we possibly can.
Well, Mr. Framan can.
Ask John Corley, and I thank the Minister for his answer to date. And I know that the employer-led apprentices was something that had been discussed at the committee over a lengthy period of time. But I had raised some concerns, and whilst it's a good scheme, is that there are quite a number of people who would fit into the NEET strategy who would find it a difficult thing. How do you ensure that it doesn't move on and these people are left behind? Because I think that's the type of people that Robin might have been talking about also.
Again, I thank the member for his comments, and it's important that we see our new apprenticeship system as part of a full spectrum of interventions. In addition to the new apprenticeship strategy, which covers levels 3 through to level 8, we have the new youth training strategy at level 2. That's designed to address those young people who are leaving school, perhaps without yet the qualifications to engage in the world of work, but very clearly have that potential. Beyond that, we have to look to see for those who aren't at that stage eligible for the youth training training scheme, how we can assist with those, and that's where what we do around the NEET strategy is so important. That obviously that's supported by the European Social Fund at present. In all of these things, we have to recognise that we have to encourage people to progress and fulfil their full potential, wherever that may be. But certainly we have a challenge of ensuring that we move as many people up the skills ladder as we possibly can, because we know the profile of where job opportunities will be created in the years to come is moving more towards the intermediate and high-level skills, and opportunities at lower-level skills are set to diminish quite radically over the coming years.
Mr. Adrian Cochrane-Watson.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I thank the Minister for his answer to the initial question? Does the Minister believe that his changes to future apprenticeships will change the image of apprenticeships and indeed engage parents into believing that apprenticeships are a positive way into the local job markets for their sons and daughters?
Yes, I very much concur with what the member is suggesting. It's important that we establish apprenticeships as a pathway that has the same parity of esteem as the more traditional routes into a college or university. And indeed, an apprenticeship will often combine college support and indeed university support, depending upon the particular type of apprenticeship and the level at which it is offered. We should not see a hierarchy where, for example, at A levels, that if people don't get into university, they then consider an apprenticeship. Apprenticeships have to be seen on a par, and that's why we're developing a central service. That's why we're trying to develop a portal that will market apprenticeship opportunities and put them in front of young people. That's why we are reforming careers policy and guidance in Northern Ireland to ensure that we have a much more modern system that's informed where opportunities lie in our economy. And we do need to get the message out that often people can actually reach even greater heights in terms of society and where they are in the economy through the apprenticeship route than they may do through the more traditional routes that people are well used to and familiar with. And indeed, as the member suggests, it's important that we convince parents of this change in approach to what is actually a much more lucrative approach, both for the individual and for the economy as a whole.
Ms. Anna Lowe.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Minister mentioned the new strategy for apprenticeship. Can I ask the Minister what different outcomes can we expect from the new strategy?
Thank you, Member, for her question. This is very much about how we can support the economy in Northern Ireland. Apprenticeships aren't simply there as an end in themselves. This is about providing a much more efficient and effective way of delivering outcomes. We know that employers have often expressed frustrations at not getting the particular skills that they require. Well, this is the most effective way of remedying that situation. We also know from the perspective of a young person, this will be the most reliable way of them finding and sustaining employment. And as we look around the European Union, we see that those societies that invest the most in apprenticeship and vocational training are those that are A, most prosperous, and B, also have some of the lowest levels of youth unemployment. So there's some very clear lessons for us there in terms of what we can be aspiring towards.
Well, Mr. Trevor Lund for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Question 2, Minister.
Thank you. The Chancellor of the Exchequer has announced his intention to introduce an apprenticeship levy for all UK private and public sector employees from April 2017. The levy will be set at half of 1% of an employer's total wage bill. All eligible local business and public sector organisations will pay the levy. All employers with an annual pay bill of over £3 million per annum are expected to be net contributors. Levy proceeds are to be used specifically to fund apprenticeship training in England. As apprenticeship policy is a devolved matter, Northern Ireland and the other devolved administrations will receive a proportionate share of the proceeds. While I fully support the development of a wider range of apprenticeships in both the private and public sector, in many ways the UK government's proposed apprenticeship levy could be viewed as an additional tax to business, not only in Northern Ireland but across the UK. Furthermore, it has the potential to undermine the different apprenticeship strategies in each of the devolved regions and cut across the policy-making prerogatives of each of the administrations with respect to what is a devolved matter. Northern Ireland employers will be expected to pay the apprenticeship levy, and I wish to ensure a fair and equitable reimbursement of the monies raised to Northern Ireland and other devolved administrations. I've held discussions with the Finance Minister and with my counterparts in Scotland and Wales and with the Biz Skills Minister to press Northern Ireland's position and to ensure that any monies due to Northern Ireland as a result of the levy's introduction are available to the new Department of the Economy to underpin the reforms we are making to Northern Ireland's apprenticeship system and to support the wider skill needs of the economy.
Mr Lund for supplementary.
Yes, I thank the Minister for his answer so far. Does he feel that this levy has the potential to undermine our local apprenticeship strategy, and if so, in what way?
What's happening is this is a strategy that's been designed by, first of all, the Treasury as a means of raising additional revenue as part of their efforts to pay down the overall UK deficit. It's also then, secondly, based around what is the nature of the apprenticeship strategy in England, with very little consideration to the impact of the strategies in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. In England, they are very fixated around this target of reaching 3 million apprentices, and there is a danger that they end up badging any form of in-work training as an apprenticeship, and you can find a bizarre situation where people are given certificates as their apprentice without ever knowing that they've been on an apprenticeship type course. So they're in a race around volume with very little consideration around quality. In the three devolved regions, we are very focused on building up quality brands around apprenticeships and ensuring that we are addressing the particular needs of our economy. There will be a distortion in that we will see in Northern Ireland probably some of our large companies paying an amount of money in excess of their capacity to spend the equivalent on training. They will feel that, in essence, they have been taxed. That will be viewed as being something that is anti-competitive. Frankly, it actually chips away at what we're doing around the lower level of corporation tax in terms of that positive intervention. So we are going to see the potential for distortion in terms of our local businesses and how they will spend their money, distortions in terms of how the North End Executive allocates its money, and something that will actually undermine our policy intent in terms of what we're trying to do as a devolved administration.
Call Mr Daniel McCross.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Can I ask the Minister which industries or sectors have proved most supportive of the levy?
Well, I'm not aware of any sectors being in support of the levy. I mean, this is essentially a tax on business. It's not something that is necessary. We don't have a situation in terms of funding of apprenticeships that's so fundamentally broken that we have to move to a levy. The genesis of this lies in terms of the UK Treasury wanting to rebalance the UK's public finances and seeing this as one route around which they can do this. This will have major impacts on different types of business, and the impacts will be greater in some businesses than others. If you're a business that is very high added value and you're paying, for example, quite high wage bills, and you have low training needs, this will hit you disproportionately. Others may affect to a lesser extent. For example, if you're in a business in a declining sector, for example, the steel industry in parts of the UK where there's no real ambition to be hiring new staff, there isn't the same onus in training as there would be in other fast-growing sectors. But irrespective of the nature of a business, the nature of that particular aspect of the economy, businesses will be taxed nonetheless based upon their overall size of their wage bill. So there's deep concern right across the board. This is actually felt both by the business organisations and the trade unions. So this is something that they are both united in their opposition towards.
Robin Newton.
Can I thank the Minister for his confirmation that there will be a levy in 2017 on the various sectors of industry? Isn't this really, Minister, really just the first step in us going back to what was historical for the establishment of the sector skills councils or industrial training boards?
I will have sympathy with what the member is saying, and at first glance, the notion of a levy seems a much more of a benign concept than a tax. If we had a situation where there was a levy that was hypothecated towards skills interventions on a standalone basis, yes, that would be a good intervention. The difficulty here is this will be a levy on business. And this will be paid by businesses in Northern Ireland. At the same time, we will suffer a negative barter consequential because there will be a massive cut to the biz budget in London, which will then filter down to each of the devolved administrations. So what we're seeing is simply a shift in terms of how training will be funded, but in a way that distorts our policy preferences and will add a very significant degree of administration at the same time, which is a leakage of money out of the system that could otherwise be better spent in terms of the front line in terms of training.
Mrs. Dolores Kelly for a question.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Question 3, Minister.
The consultation on the employment strategy for people with disabilities closed on the 27th of November last year. 58 responses were received, 32 from individuals and 26 on behalf of organisations. In addition, information was gathered at 4 public consultation events and 2 smaller events with specific disability groups. The consultation period has enabled all interested parties to submit official responses and provide feedback on each of the key themes and subsequent proposals. This has been broadly very positive, and a number of constructive suggestions have been made which will inform the final strategy document. The Committee for Employment and Learning has been briefed by my officials and provided with detailed summary on findings. Same will apply to the Draft Disability Strategic Working Group, who helped develop the strategy. In relation to the big conversation, this was launched on the 15th of September as an innovative approach to engaging with people about the sustainability of our higher education system. It concluded on the 23rd of October. During the budget process for 2016-17, I wrote to my executive colleagues to report on the findings of the big conversation, to outline the extent of our funding challenges and to present a range of potential long-term solutions. The paper has led to some encouraging budget outcomes for that financial year, which I hope can prevent further cuts to higher education despite an overall reduction to my department's equivalent budget. However, looking ahead, it will not simply be enough to protect what we have in terms of skills provision, and further consideration of the long-term options available to us will be required in the context of the next comprehensive spending review. My department expects to publish a response to both of these exercises in the coming weeks.
Ms. Kelly for supplementary.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer. Perhaps the Minister could share with this House what his thoughts are in moving forward in terms of the scope and the nature and the criteria, and how he could undertake to collaborate, particularly with the Minister for Health, given that many people who have attended daycare facilities will be finding reduction in their services and seeking to have more positive lives and meaningful support within the community through further and higher education.
Yeah, well, it's important that members understand what the Disability Employment Strategy is seeking to do, which is about supporting people in terms of employment, and will work very focused on terms of those type of employment outcomes. It will, however, be part of a wider landscape of interventions that will work in collaboration with other departments as we look to ensure a much more rounded outcome. In that respect, I would draw attention, first of all, to the work we're doing around learning disability transitions as an executive subcommittee, and the fact that there's an action plan in place to facilitate that. Secondly, we have an economic and activity strategy, again, which does focus to a very considerable extent around disability issues. And within that, there is the potential for, and indeed a number of projects have already been identified, that involve a collaboration between other departments and the Department of Health around the type of outcome that the member is suggesting. Now, while that strategy has been agreed by the executive, as of yet, there's been no significant funding allocated towards it, and that's certainly a situation that I find troubling, and I would certainly encourage those who are in office after May to consider remedying that situation as a matter of priority.
Ronan McGann.
And I thank the Minister for his response so far. And within the context of the big conversation, does the Minister acknowledge the absolute importance of part-time higher education and the significant impact that it has on the lives of individuals, in particular women, in providing opportunities?
Well, I certainly acknowledge the importance of the part-time route in terms of higher education and also postgraduate. And the member will be aware that we have last year engaged in a consultation around different funding models in that regard, and I have informed the House as to how, in principle, I wish those to go forward. I am hoping to confirm that position within, indeed, the coming weeks, and discussions are still ongoing with the Treasury and the Student Loans Company as to how we can implement the preferred way forward on the back of that consultation. But we absolutely want to see an increase in terms of part-time study, and it does, for example, tie in with the apprenticeship strategy as being a means by which we are going to ensure that people are increasingly trained at a high level in terms of what's required of businesses and other organisations.
Mrs. Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. More consultations, Minister, on an issue, especially in relation to people with disabilities, where action is long overdue. The Minister is aware of my support for organisations like 180 Restaurant in my own constituency of Upper Ban, which are helping to provide employment opportunities for young people with disabilities. So can I ask what reassurance will be provided to them and others that help is coming, not a consultation followed by another consultation, that they are getting the help and support that they desperately need?
Well, I dare say the member is making some rather spurious comments, because on the one hand she's asking me to give reassurance to an organisation that their particular interests will be taken on board, and then she's damning the process of consultation. The process of consultation is designed for that very purpose, where organisations will come forward with their very particular points of view, and the first draft of a strategy will be published. We will then hear the feedback from organisations and make whatever adjustments that are required. We have not had multiple consultations around any of these things. We have had a disability employment strategy that has gone out for a public consultation. There is a requirement on us to do that. If we don't do that, we will be judicially reviewed. That is the nature of how government does business. I'm committed to actually delivering the strategy before I leave office. It will be delivered before I leave office. So we have had action, not talk. We have real action on this issue.
Mr. Gerard Diver for a question.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Question for Minister.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, with your permission, I wish to group questions 4 and 8. My department received the latest version of the outline business case on the 22nd of January 2016. My officials are currently reviewing this, looking to the extent to which the previous comments provided on the 1st of July 2015 regarding the version submitted in June 2015 have been addressed, as well as consideration of any additional information provided. A formal response will issue on the latest case as soon as possible.
Mr. Gerard Diver for supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Minister, thank you for your answer. Obviously, given the false dawns that we've had before in relation to the expansion of the Magee campus, oversight and stewardship of the business case going forward is going to be critically important in the uncertain context of moving from one department to a new department. Can the Minister give the House assurance that the same team will be working on the business plan and that it will be followed up assiduously? Thank you.
Well, starting from the back first, the officials, the same unit as transfers into the new department will be working on this. There may well be some change in personnel, as is the case in every aspect of government, but there will be no more or less continuity in this than anything else. I do want to take issue with the member around sort of the point he's made around false dawns. I certainly haven't been involved in any false dawns around all of this. I've made clear all along that I support the expansion of Ulster University at Magee is something I would like to see happening. It is clear that we do need to be producing more graduates, particularly those that are linked into the needs of our economy. But all along I have been very clear that we cannot expand the University of Ulster at Magee unless collectively this Assembly is prepared to ensure that more resource is allocated towards higher education. We currently have a structural deficit in terms of higher education, which we have to fix. We have to fix the foundations before we can build any more in terms of further investment. Now, members should be very clear what is involved in that respect. We have to reverse the 16 million cuts from the 2015-16 financial year. We have to address the £40 million structural deficit. And then we can look to what will be a recurring cost of around £30 million for us to proceed with the expansion of the numbers at Magee. I have to say to the member and his party, and indeed others, it's not good enough to simply talk about this and to make commitments rhetorically towards the expansion. You have to show a coherent approach to the public finances in Northern Ireland that will allow us to do these type of projects that are very much in our interest. And we haven't had that collectively across the parties for quite some time.
Mr. Raymond McCartney.
Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker. And can I thank the Minister for his very frank answer there? Indeed, welcome his continuing support for the expansion of Magee. I'm just wondering, as we take the business case forward, in terms of the timeline, if you give some indication of that, and whether or not he thinks a centre of excellence, perhaps based at the Magee campus, can assist the process of ensuring its expansion.
Well, I can't give a reliable answer in terms of the timeline at this stage, because that is subject to the ongoing scrutiny of the business case by my officials. If the economists in the department are content with it, they will then pass it to DfP for their consideration. In the context where my officials aren't happy with it, they will have to refer back to the strategy board for further comment and further amendment of the business case. You will appreciate from my original answer that we've already been down that road before, and issues were raised in terms of what was produced in the summer of last year. It took quite some time before the revised business case came back to the department. So whether this is the final stage of the process that we're now in, or whether we'll have to go through another iteration, really much depends upon that particular point around scrutiny. But the issue that, again, I reiterate to the member, it isn't one about the capacity of either the City Council or the consultants or the university to produce a business case. The answer to the question as to whether Magee will expand is how it is going to be resourced by the executive. And the resources have to be found, and they have to be found in a way that actually is sustainable. And I spelt out the costs that are involved in terms of addressing our wider higher education system in Northern Ireland. And I would say you cannot expand Magee unless you fix the wider problems first. And then you have the platform around which we can expand our provision. The case for more graduates is clear, but we have to make sure that we do this in the appropriate and orderly manner. And we do need to see a commitment across all parties that we will properly resource higher education and resource higher education to the level that we require to ensure that we can support our economy.
Mrs. Sander Overend.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and thank the Minister for his response. Does the Minister agree that the expansion at Magee, which we all support, should not come at the expense or threaten the viability of any of the other university campuses here in Northern Ireland?
Absolutely. I very much concur with the comments of the member, and indeed I had a delegation from Causeway Coast and Glens Council yesterday who were making that exact point. I'm not sure if she was in communication with anyone that was on that delegation, perhaps. But let me be very clear. We have actually been able to expand Magee over the past 5 years. We have found some resource that has allowed us to do that. Now, that to an extent has been undermined by the more recent cuts. But overall, the Magee campus is bigger than it was whenever I inherited office in 2011, notwithstanding the fact that I had zero budget at that time for the expansion of Magee. It's been the policy of the university all along that they will consider any additional places that are awarded to them as being something that they can allocate to the Magee campus. But to be very clear, the expansion of Magee cannot come at the expense of undermining our existing provision. It cannot come at the cost of displacing students out of existing campuses, whether it's Ulster University or Queen's, into Derry. We need to ensure that what happens in terms of any expansion at Magee is additional. There is a very clear case that we need more graduates in Northern Ireland, and it's in that spirit that we should be approaching the issue of the expansion, subject, of course, to the money being made available by the executive.
Mr. Ian Millen for a question.
Castover Shea, question number 6.
At present, higher education students from Northern Ireland receive their maintenance support payments in 3 instalments, roughly at the beginning of each term of the academic year. This triannual payment system supports students with any upfront costs which they might face at the beginning of term, while also allowing them to budget ahead accordingly. However, concerns have been raised in recent times that large and infrequent payments can heighten the risk of financial mismanagement and, by extension, financial hardship among students. It was in response to these concerns that I launched a consultation in August last year to consider options to change the frequency of these maintenance payments. The consultation closed on the 27th of September, and a summary of responses is available on the Department's website. There was no clear consensus amongst respondents about which option was preferable, and many expressed concerns over the potential cost of implementing a move to more frequent payments, particularly if that were to detract from other areas of higher education funding. Any decision to invest in a more frequent payment system will therefore have to be considered within the context of the overall higher education budget and the competing priorities within it, including, for example, our ambitions to expand student places. With regards to the timing of a decision, it has emerged in recent months that the Student Loans Company has become overburdened by the demands of other administrations, i.e. England, and the earliest year at which changes could possibly be implemented will be 2017 and 2018. In principle, I am open to a change, but the timelines are such that it will fall to a future minister to take a final decision on the matter, and he or she will have to do so within the context of the overall higher education budget.
Call Mr. Millen for a very quick supplementary.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his very comprehensive, detailed response. In your final deliberations, will the Minister ensure that students' best interests will be at the heart of the decisions that you make?
Mr. Please.
Okay, well, very briefly, yes, but the member needs to define what is meant by students' best interests. Some will say more frequent payments, some will say more places available locally, because we're displacing too many students out of Northern Ireland where they're paying more costly fees. So we have to take this in the round. Is that quick enough?
That ends the period for listed questions. We will now move on to topical questions. And I call Mr. Fergal McKinney. Mr. McKinney.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I return to the issue of university finance? And could the Minister outline the extent to which the Ulster University and Queen's will face further cuts under the proposed budget?
Well, thank the member for his question. We're still working through the figures from the budget at this stage in terms of exactly what's going to happen in terms of the teaching and research grant to the universities for the forthcoming financial and academic years. At this stage, not least because we have had the allocation of the additional £20 million that is due to be forthcoming to the new Department of the Economy for skills to be allocated officially in the June monitoring round. We should be in a position where we can avoid any further cuts to teaching and research grant in terms of the road ahead. But I would wish to caution the Assembly and indeed stress to the member that the cuts from the 2015-16 financial year of £16 million to higher education, those cuts are still in the system, and we've only seen the first third of those being implemented in terms of entry in terms of September 15. And as things stand, those are still in the system for September 16 entry and September 17 entry. Now, there may be some scope to mitigate those to a small extent, but as things currently stand, the vast bulk of those are set to go ahead, so by no means are we out of the woods yet. And even if we were in a situation that was a standstill, we have to be investing further in our higher education, because we have to ensure that we're meeting the needs of a high-skilled economy.
Any for supplementary?
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And while, of course, the focus is on that strategic level and on the headline finance, my further focus is on the students themselves, the customers, if you like. And can the Minister give an assurance that grants, especially for those from a vulnerable and poorer background, will not be cut?
I'm happy to give that assurance, and the House will well know that right across the piece we have been ensuring that the student support system has remained in place despite all the tribulations we've had over budgets in terms of recent years. Some, of course, are demand-led interventions. Sometimes we may not spend our full budget allocation, but the levels of entitlement and the amount of money available as part of those entitlements has not been affected.
Mr. Alban McGuinness for a topical question.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And could I ask the Minister, in relation to student accommodation in Belfast for university students, would the Minister like to comment on what appears to be a frenzy of planning applications in relation to student accommodation, both in North Belfast and also in South Belfast, and the fact that it appears that the universities are just simply allowing these applications to develop in a free market without any plan or any control?
Well, first of all, I think it's important to acknowledge the fact that we are having this interest in student accommodation. In one respect, it's actually a very positive sign. It's a sign that our universities are still flourishing despite all they've been through in terms of cuts. That attracting students, particularly international students, is something that's very much on their agendas. That's important for openness and diversity and plugging in to the rest of the world. And I would stress that doesn't come at the expense of opportunities for local students at the same time. In terms of accommodation, we are seeing different approaches depending upon which of the universities that we are talking about. Obviously, with Queen's. Queen's have moved ahead with their own projects in terms of their own managed accommodation. Ulster University is adopting a situation where the private sector is responding. I wouldn't say it's fair to say that there is no control in that regard, because obviously what happens is controlled by planning, both in terms of land use and also in terms of the regulation of individual applications. In that respect, Belfast City Council is the lead authority with responsibility. And you are seeing, obviously, the Council going through their own processes and in some cases granting approval, in other cases not. The overall level of applications coming forward for housing is probably going to be in excess of the actual need itself, but that process is working its way through the system. There's also various working groups and interventions that have been organised primarily through, first of all, Belfast City Council, but also under the auspices of the Department of Social Development around how we best manage a whole host of issues in relation to the university expansion. Housing is one of those, but also transport issues and parking are also equally as important.
McGuinness for a supplement.
I thank the Minister for his answer, but in a sense, the Minister's avoiding the real issue, which is that this is an unplanned, in terms of overall structure, an unplanned series of developments, which can have impacts, negative impacts, as well as positive impacts, on local communities. And is it not necessary that both universities get together, along with Belfast City Council and any other planning authority, in order to work through, together with your department, and satisfy the needs of students?
Well, I can assure the member that process is already happening, and those structures exist, and indeed that they're being revamped and giving much stronger input. I mean, we're having discussions between departments at ministerial and permanent secretary levels. Those discussions are happening, and they're focused on housing and transport and parking issues. But let me be clear, I'm the minister with responsibility for universities. Now, universities don't exist in the bubble. They have to be take account of the context in which they exist. But our departments also have responsibilities in relation to this piece. Obviously, social development has a very clear role with respect to housing and of an urban regeneration powers. The Department of Environment, which the member's colleague is the minister of, has responsibility in terms of some planning powers. The council has responsibility in terms of some planning powers. The Department of Regional Development is responsible for transport, including public transport. This has to be a multi-department, a multi-agency approach. The structures exist. What we do need to see is people bringing stuff to the table in terms of solutions to some of the problems that still have to be addressed.
Mr. Trevor Lund for a topical question.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister for his assessment of the implications for Northern Ireland from the Business Innovation and Skills Higher Education Green Paper, please?
Thank the Member for the question. This is another example of where policy has been set by the UK Department on the surface to meet the needs of England, but where there are some various spillover effects in terms of what happens in terms of the other jurisdictions. So what we're seeing in terms of higher education is a major divergence of policy, on the one hand between England and on the other hand between the three devolved administrations. In England, they're going for very much for a deregulated system. They have fee levels of 9,000 with the potential to go beyond 9,000. They're opening up their market to all sorts of providers, including some very small providers. They're trying to put in place a new teaching excellence framework that will allow judgments to be made over what can be funded or not funded, which perhaps doesn't really address the needs of what happens in Northern Ireland. There is some potential threat towards HEFCA, which something which on the surface is the Funding Council for England, will also perform some functions for all of the UK in relation to research, and that its existence is currently under threat. There's also some positive things that are happening around widening participation agenda, where actually England has some very positive lessons to learn from Northern Ireland.
Lund for supplementary.
Yes, I thank the Minister for his answer. Can I ask him what actions he's taking to represent the interests of Northern Ireland and the local universities in this process?
Well, first of all, within Northern Ireland, my department has coordinated a response from all of our HEIs, to which we made our views known as part of the formal consultation exercise. We've also had discussions between the three devolved ministers around how we can formulate a common approach to trying to address some of the issues, particularly those with the greatest impact in terms of spillover issues. I've spoken already to Joe Johnson, the Minister for Universities within BIS, and within the very near future I expect that the three devolved ministers will sit down with him to have a quadrilateral to discuss these issues.
Ms Claire Hannah for topical questions.
Thank you, Mr Speaker, and thank the Minister for his questions his answers so far. Can he outline the impact the loss of the Horizon 2020 fund would have on local universities in the event of a UK withdrawal from the EU?
Well, that almost sounds like a planned question there, but it sounds... It would be quite catastrophic, and as the member will know, we're talking about a fund that amounts to close to 80 billion euro over the next 7 years. That is a European-wide intervention, and provides added value in terms of what can be done through the QR funding that we give domestically to our universities. We have other pots of international funding we can also access. But Horizon 2020 provides new openings and also provides the opportunity for partnerships to be built across national boundaries. And that's very important in terms of the modern world of research, where things don't exist in a bubble. And particularly on some very sophisticated research projects, you need to have that scalability and to bring a lot of partners in from different institutions. That simply wouldn't happen to the same extent if we had a purely a situation where the UK was going alone in terms of Horizon 2020. Some people may make an argument that additional funding would be made available to research, but you would lose the added value that comes from that potential for international collaboration between academics in one jurisdiction and another.
Anna for supplementary.
I thank the Minister, and I can assure the other members that that wasn't a planted question, and neither is this one. But has the Minister's department done a wider audit of the funding and opportunities that would be lost in the unfortunate event of a Brexit, and how that funding shortfall or deficit would be met within departmental resources?
Well, I have to say to the member, there isn't really a plan B in this regard. If we lose the European money, we lose the European money, and we are going to suffer as a consequence of that. That will be very much to our detriment. In addition, obviously, to Horizon 2020, my department probably avails of probably more pots of European funding than any other department. Obviously, we lose Erasmus Plus. It's not just an issue of funding. That's also about opening up opportunities for our young people to experience learning in different parts of the European Union and indeed elsewhere. That's incredibly important. That's now been extended to apprentices, so we can have exchanges outside the context of just university students. But obviously, we have the European Social Fund, which makes an enormous difference and allows us to do things that we simply couldn't do within our own existing mainstream budgets. So we can't simply recoup that money. And anyone who thinks that we're going to get a big paycheck from the UK Treasury to make up the shortfall that we're going to lose from European money is in la-la land.
Mr David McElveen for a topical question.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. I wonder, could I ask the Minister to update the House today as to how the initiatives have been going in relating to reskilling of employees who have either lost their jobs or are due to lose their jobs as a result of both the closures of JTI and Michelin and Ballymena?
And the member will know there was a meeting yesterday in terms of the task force that the Council is coordinating with a view to addressing a whole range of different points in relation to manufacturing and skills. And obviously, my department plays a role within that, as does DETI and some other government departments. Beyond the broader issues, there are the very particular points around both JTI and Michelin. Obviously, as the member will appreciate, there are different points in terms of the process with the JTI announcement is now well advanced. We have been investing, and my department has been funding some very particular interventions around courses that aren't otherwise available. And also, there's been some very particular interventions around essential skills for some of the staff. The process is at a different scale, different stage in relation to Michelin, because the 90-day consultation period around collective redundancies hasn't yet formally come to an end. I believe that will happen at the beginning of March, and at that stage, then the nature of the engagement will change gears quite significantly.
Mr. Michael Veen, for a supplementary, I'd ask the member and the minister to be reasonably brief.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I will try my very best on this. Whilst the Minister obviously be coming to the dawning of the age of the Department of Employment and Learning, it is obviously an opportunity for reflection. Whilst the Minister has, I'm sure, been very good in delivering initiatives, some may say that he has not been just so successful in delivering reforms. I wonder, would the Minister like to update the House today as to the reform that he is most proud of in his 5 years of the Employment and Learning Minister?
Yes. Slightly separate from the original topical, but one word, the apprenticeship strategy. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Two words. Yeah,
yeah. Order, time is up.